Good morning. My name is Desmond McNeil. I come from the University of Oslo in Norway, and I will be introducing and chairing this session on trade and investment agreements, the threat to people's health. I'm sorry to say we are slightly fewer than originally planned. I'll just briefly introduce them. Ted Schrecker at the end is from the, he's a professor at Durham University in UK. Andrew Mitchell on my left is a professor at Melbourne Law School in Australia. And Sanya Reed-Smith is legal advisor and senior researcher at the Third World Network. The purpose of this session is to present and discuss the claim that trade and investment agreements are a threat to people's health. That may seem slightly odd to have presenting this here at the WTO ministerial, but it seemed to us that, in fact, it would be a good discipline for us to present this in what might be a critical context. So we're hoping that we will have a good discussion, but also open up for, let's say, contradictory views to the claim that at least some of us are making. When I say that some of us are making, I should explain that this work is based on a paper, a report, which we have prepared, which will be published in the Lancet with the same title that I've just announced. And that is a paper which is produced by a group of us, chaired by myself and including Ted Schrecker. But our other two panelists are not a part of that. They will have the opportunity to comment in their remarks, if they wish, on the draft which is so far available. So I'd like to start by introducing a little of the background, how this independent panel came about, if you like, the politics of it. Because it goes back to an initiative some years ago by seven ministries of foreign affairs. The ministers of foreign affairs of Norway and France, together with Brazil, Indonesia, Senegal, South Africa, and Thailand. And the interest of these seven ministers was in linking the topic of global health to foreign policy, to see health as an important issue in foreign policy terms. And they came together, let me take this a little bit further. So the Oslo Ministerial Declaration on Global Health and Foreign Policy from 2007 was a statement by these seven ministers, which was published in the Lancet. And just a brief, two brief quotes from that statement. The purpose was to bring health issues more strongly into the arena of foreign policy and to make an impact on health a point of departure and a defining lens that each country will use to examine their foreign policy and development strategies. Now, as a result, from that initiative, there followed a process which led to the establishment of a commission. Out of this came a, was established a commission with Lancet and University of Oslo Commission on, which built on the WHO Commission on Social Determinants of Health, Closing the Gap in a Generation. Some of you may know about this commission led by Sir Michael Marmot, which was on the social determinants of health. The new commission of the Lancet University of Oslo took this process one step further, looking not simply at the social determinants of health, but at the political determinants of health. That is, if you like, what lies behind the social determinants, to try and understand what the factors that, to a large extent, hinder progress in the health sector, the global forces, if you like. underlying the social and constraining efforts to improve the global health situation. The commission, I won't go through all the different members, but there were 18 members, chaired by the rector of the University of Oslo, co-chaired by Jashodhara Dasgupta from India, not representing, but coming from a large range of different countries and organizations across the world. Some of these you may recognize yourself, but as I say, I won't go into the detail of the listing of all those panel members. But the outcome of that commission, of which I was also a member, was this report published in the Lancet. The approach of that commission was to look at a number of different areas, or different sectors or policy areas, and to try and understand and critically review the governance dimensions, how the governance aspects in these different areas impacted on global health. The interest, if you like, was what happens outside the health sector, outside the remit of the WHO and the Ministry of Health, which impacts on global health. And the topics, the seven policy areas listed here, violent conflicts, immigration policies, intellectual property rights, transnational corporate activity, food security and agriculture, economic crises and responses, and foreign investment treaties. In each case, these different policy areas can have a very substantial impact on global health, but outside the control of those who are directly responsible for health. So the question was, how is health impacted by the governance of these different areas? And one of those seven that we chose was, I'm not having much luck with this. Excuse me, I'm sorry about this. Okay, finally getting it, finally worked out the technology. So one of the areas that we looked at was foreign investment treaties and limited policy space. And of course, one of the classic examples of this, which we will be discussing perhaps in the remainder of the session, was the question of attempts by Philip Morris to reverse Uruguay's developing activities to limit tobacco use. So this is just one of many examples that we use to illustrate the issues of concern. Very briefly, and I'll give you the reference to the full report if you have the interest. Very briefly, the key message was as follows, that power asymmetry and global social norms constrain action on health inequity. These are reinforced by systemic global governance dysfunctions. Secondly, that the unacceptable health inequities require global political solutions. And as a recommendation, there should be independent monitoring to counter the global political forces that are detrimental to health. So following up on that commission, we said, okay, by what means can we facilitate independent monitoring? And the panel, which I will be briefly presenting, the work of the panel was an attempt to follow up that recommendation of monitoring. And so, following up the commission report, was established the independent panel and advisory board on global governance for health. So the independent panel of seven members, which I chair, seven members to look in more detail at the specific issue of trade and investment agreements. There was a commitment by the Lancet to publish the findings. And as I say, in 2015, this panel was established to look specifically at the issue of trade and investment agreements. These are the members of that independent panel. In addition to myself, Alicia Barcena, the Executive Secretary of CEPAL in Latin America, Sakiko Fukuda-Pal, professor at the New School in New York, Anand Grover, designated senior advocate and UN Special Rapporteur on the Right to Health from 2008 to 2014, Ted Schrecker, who is here with me, professor of global health policy at Durham University, David Stuckler, professor of political economy and sociology at University of Oxford, and Caroline Deer Birkbeck, who is from the senior researcher at the University of Oxford, Global Economic Governance. If you would like to follow up and find out more about our work, the references are there. That is a reference on the independent panel and a reference on the commission which established that independent panel. So that very briefly is, if you like, the background to the work of the panel. I'm now going to invite Ted Schrecker to summarize the findings of our work, followed by Andrew and Sonia, who will comment on that, and then open up for discussion with you also in the group here. Thank you very much. I hand over now to Ted Schrecker.
Thank you very much. I'll wait just a second for the slides to come up. Oh, okay. Excellent, thanks. Well, this is a small but enthusiastic group. It reminds me of some of my early morning seminars. Hey, as Desmond mentioned, what I'm going to try to do is provide an overview, and it really is an overview of what is already a fairly dense paper setting out the case that there is, in fact, a threat to people's health from contemporary trade and investment agreements. But first of all, just a bit of background. It's not all that long ago that Richard Feacham came out with his famous dictum that globalization is good for your health mostly because the opening of the lowering of barriers to trade and investment leads to more rapid economic growth, which in turn makes more resources available for poverty reduction and investment in healthcare systems. Now, there were internal problems with that analysis, most notably in how he distinguished what he called globalizers and non-globalizers. But some of the more basic issues that have emerged since then, thanks to critical analysis by academics and perhaps even more importantly by civil society organizations like ICTSD, are things like the unequal distribution of economic gains. In fact, it is now much more widely accepted than it would have been even a few years ago that globalization is disequalizing. And also phenomena like the barriers to access to medicines that persist despite efforts to establish flexibilities in the global trade regime. So if we fast forward to the report of the Lancet Commission that Desmond described, we find health inequity identified as resulting from transnational activities that involve actors with different interests and degrees of power, which is the generic description of the contemporary economic order of which trade and investment agreements are only a part. And although the focus here, of course, is strictly on those agreements, I would emphasize that they're only a part of that order, although a very important part. They're important because they essentially rewrite the rules of the world economy. And they operate not only at the border, as was the case for an earlier generation of trade agreements, but also behind the border, restricting this policy space that governments have to do many things, including protect public health. And I would emphasize that restricting policy space is not a byproduct of these agreements in most cases. It is their intention. Some of the key areas where we have evidence about negative health impacts, possibly the one where the evidence is clearest, apart from tobacco control, which my fellow panelists are going to be talking about, is the evidence that trade and investment liberalization facilitates various transformations of national food systems that lead to rapid increases in overweight and obesity. And the cross-national evidence here, much of which has been generated by David Stuckler and colleagues, is in fact quite clear. Less widely publicized is the possibility that trade and investment agreements could threaten a precautionary approach to health risk regulation by, for example, by entrenching a requirement for scientific risk assessments. Now, you may say, who would want an unscientific risk assessment? The point here is that the requirement for scientific risk assessments in practice means a very high standard of proof that a hazard exists. And that standard of proof may, in a health policy context, be inappropriate. Then there are, of course, the intellectual property provisions of TRIPS, and perhaps more seriously, the TRIPS plus provisions that limit access to essential medicines. You may say, what about the Doha Declaration and the flexibilities it entrenched? Well, the evidence is that those flexibilities have been used only in a very limited number of cases for a variety of reasons. And contemporary trade and investment agreements have the potential to increase the segmentation of national labor markets and the rise of precarious employment that is increasingly understood as a risk to health in and of itself. Right. So those are the on-the-ground impacts. At the level of process and politics, contemporary trade and investment agreements entrench the power asymmetries that were a central concern of that Lancet Commission in three ways. They entrench power asymmetries in making the rules, for example, because corporate lobbyists, roughly 600 of them in the case of the United States and the Trans-Pacific Partnership, have preferred access to decision makers. And at the level of national interactions, governments may face hard choices between, for example, seeking to use TRIPS flexibilities and gaining access to markets in negotiations that are superficially unrelated. They entrench asymmetries at the level of implementing the rules, for example, because inequalities in market size mean that one country may have much more to lose than another from engaging in a particular dispute settlement process, even if it wins. And then you have asymmetries entrenched at the level of adjudicating the rules. I mentioned the issue of standards of proof. We know that states have to meet a high and unpredictable standard of proof in defending measures on public health grounds. The power imbalance at the level of adjudication is especially striking in the case of ISDS provisions, about which I'll have a bit more to say later. They essentially constitutionalize a particular economic order in ways that can be quite destructive, both of health and more generally of political accountability. Well, our generic policy prescription here is that global governance must prioritize the ability and obligation of states to protect and promote public health, not least as a human right. And in this vein, it's useful to note the recommendation made by Olivier de Schutter when he was United Nations Special Rapporteur on the Right to Food for human rights impact assessments of trade and investment agreements in advance of the conclusion of the agreements, with options to include amending or terminating the agreement. And he made that recommendation specifically in the context of food and health, but it has much broader application. Well, what to do about all this? Our recommendations, and I'm reproducing these directly from the paper that's now under review, are six in number, and again, they're fairly generic, directed mainly but not exclusively at national governments. The first of these is to ensure transparency and accountability, which is pretty straightforward. It requires, inter alia, that the corporate sector and its representatives not have preferential access to negotiating processes. Second, protect policy space. Again, this is generic. Governments shouldn't adopt measures that will limit the ability to adopt what they consider appropriate health protection policies. They should also have procedures in place to ensure that they're capable of making that judgment. And at least until recently, many governments, including governments in some sophisticated high-income jurisdictions, didn't have that capability. Third, protect access to essential medicines and healthcare services. We flagged the emerging consensus around progress toward universal health coverage as being extremely important as a strategy for advancing the right to health. And in that context, policy coherence requires that governments not make any commitments that might hinder progress toward universal health care, either by way of limiting access to essential medicines or by way of, for example, locking in the privatization or commercialization of healthcare services. Fourth, we recommended an end to current and future use of investor-state dispute settlement provisions, which I'll say a bit more about later. Fifth, this is perhaps the most innovative of our recommendations. We argue that states' treaty obligations in areas other than trade, for example, human rights, should be admissible as arguments in dispute resolution. In other words, you can think of this as a human rights carve-out. This is all fairly negative, and a lot of the public health community's response to trade and investment policy tends to have been reactive. But we thought it was important to go beyond that, to think big and think new.
Right.
And I think this gathering as a whole is an example of that kind of big thinking at work. It's really important to explore examples for international trade cooperation that go beyond the reactive, that would actually entrench the new partnership for development that was talked about but not taken terribly seriously, I think, in the context of the Millennium Development Goals. And the SDGs, just recently adopted, may open a window of opportunity that wasn't there before, because the SDGs, as they relate to health, are extremely broad indeed. Well, I said I was going to focus a bit on investor-state dispute resolution provisions. The graph you see is simply an illustration of the dramatic increase in the number of cases that have been brought under the provisions of, under these various provisions. You can see that the number is still relatively small, but growing exponentially. And of course, this graph is simply shows the annual number of cases brought. If you look at the cumulative graph, it's even more impressive, but it goes way off the page. Now, I focus on investor-state dispute settlement provisions, and we did, because of something in the Lancet panel's recommendations that Desmond didn't mention. In the concluding section of its report, that Lancet panel identified what it called five systemic dysfunctions that impede global governance for health: democratic deficit, weak accountability, institutional stickiness, which sounds a bit anatomical, but is really another way of saying rigidities or path dependencies, missing or nascent institutions, and inadequate policy space for health. Now, investor-state dispute settlement provisions in anything like their present form tick all five of these boxes. The Lancet group didn't specifically identify missing or nascent institutions as a problem in the context of ISDS provisions. I would argue that it is because of, for example, the lack of an institutional framework that enables obligations to respect, protect, and fulfill the right to health to be incorporated into dispute settlement, which isn't there. That is an institutional failure that is part of, an important part of, the overall critique of ISDS provisions. And I have already gone a bit over time, so I thank you for listening and will turn the floor over to Andrew.
Could I? Just by way of introduction, I'd just like to note, for those of you who are wondering why we're talking as much about investment as trade, I should note, as some of you may be aware, that actually at the moment trade ministers here in Nairobi are in fact, or will be deciding whether to add investment to future WTO regulations. So investment is coming very much as an equally important issue with trade. And with that, I'll hand over again to Andrew.
Well, thanks very much, Desmond. I'd like to begin by saying that there isn't any inherent conflict between health and international trade investment. Obviously, there's a potential positive impact of trade and investment law on public health. So increased international trade and investment law can encourage the transfer of health technology and knowledge. It can increase the potential for healthcare spending as a result of higher economic growth. And it can increase the access to a wider range of better and cheaper health products and services. Trade and investment law also contain explicit and implicit allowances for government to protect public health, even when this has a negative impact on trade and investment. However, the potential negative impact of trade and investment on public health does need to be recognised and managed. Increased international trade and investment has tended to lead to the increased production, consumption, and marketing of products related to tobacco, alcohol, and unhealthy foods. Trade and investment agreements can also create legal risks for government. These agreements can be daunting and uncertain, and these factors can be easily exploited by and exploited and overemphasized by those with vested interests, such as the tobacco industry. So, for example, industry representatives will advise governments, particularly developing country governments, that you can't adopt this particular health measure because it will violate WTO law or violate a particular international investment agreement. In my presentation this morning, I'm going to focus on the legal risks that trade and investment agreements can create for governments pursuing public health measures. For the purposes of disclosure, I'm the recipient of two research grants from the Australian government bodies to conduct independent research on the relationship between trade and investment law and the common risk factors for non-communicable diseases, specifically tobacco use, alcohol abuse and poor diet in collaboration with the McCabe Centre for Law and Cancer, which is a joint initiative of the Cancer Council of Victoria and the Union for International Cancer Control. I'm also a member of the Australian Government's Expert Advisory Group for Plain Packaging of Tobacco Products, which is an honorary position. Now, as I mentioned before, industry arguments about the compatibility of a health measure with trade and investment obligations can have an effect, regardless of whether those legal arguments are well-founded or not. And this is because raising these doubts about a tobacco control measure or another public health measure or any other government measure can have the effect of regulatory chill. That is, rather than face the challenge that's been posed by tobacco companies and face the uncertain legality and possible failure of a particular law or regulation, a government might simply choose not to introduce a proposed measure at all. And this is particularly problematic in areas of law that are complex and highly specialised, such as international trade and investment law. Now, international trade and investment agreements can and have been used to challenge health measures. I'll provide an example of how the tobacco industry has used these agreements. So, in response to progressively stronger and wide-reaching tobacco control measures, tobacco companies are increasingly turning to international trade and investment agreement as a tool to challenge tobacco control measures. Cases that the tobacco industry has brought or supported to date include Indonesia's successful challenge before the WTO of the US exemption of menthol from its ban on flavoured cigarettes, the pending WTO claims that have been brought by Cuba, the Dominican Republic, Honduras, and Indonesia against Australia's plain or standardised packaging requirements for tobacco products, with Ukraine having suspended its claim, the ongoing action that's been brought against those same requirements by Philip Morris Asia Limited under the Hong Kong Australia Bilateral Investment Treaty, and the ongoing claim by Philip Morris companies in Switzerland against Uruguay's rules on health warnings and marketing restrictions for tobacco products, which was brought under the Uruguay-Switzerland BIT. Now, in each of these cases, the complainant argues that a tobacco control measure is inconsistent with a trade or investment agreement, and that the state that's enacted the measure must pay compensation or alter its measure. Now, although these later three disputes are yet to be resolved, the very fact that the challenges have been brought risks creating this regulatory chill that I spoke about, which so to discourage states from implementing similar tobacco control measures. Now, claims can also be made and have been made in respect of other health measures or health-related issues, such as pharmaceutical patents in connection with the issuing of a compulsory license or the allowing of parallel imports, the granting of a patent or failure to grant a patent. Also in relation to government procurement or supply of health-related goods or services. In relation to food safety regulation that affects the operations of a foreign investor in the food sector, or regulation that's designed to reduce the consumption of particular unhealthy products, such as tobacco, alcohol, or processed food, or regulations affecting individuals' health and medical professionals' ability to practice, or operations of corporate service providers, such as health insurers. So trade and investment agreements could threaten states' health policies in really two distinct ways. First, some costs arise simply from the use of dispute settlement mechanisms to challenge a particular health measure. So if the measure being challenged under an international trade or investment agreement, then the burden of having to defend the case carries with it the potential for high costs, long time frames, and a strain on human resources as well as legal expertise. Also, regardless of the outcome, which may be uncertain, these potential costs may deter states from pursuing health measures. Now, the tobacco industry has demonstrated an appetite for using litigation to contribute to regulatory chill in this way, even where it's unlikely to succeed in the legal action in question. Then secondly, additional costs arise from an adverse finding or an outcome in a dispute. So for example, if a court or a tribunal finds that the challenged measure breaches the relevant agreement. So depending on the particular rules of the agreement, the state might be required to pay compensation to the companies or to repeal a particular measure. My recommendation in response to these risks is that countries take a comprehensive approach and combine provisions in treaties that minimise the potential costs of litigation with provisions that combine that increase the likelihood of a state successfully defending health measures in such litigation. And in the next few slides, I'll illustrate how that could be done in relation to investor-state dispute settlement in investment agreements using tobacco control measures as an example. So this slide sets out options for states to control investor-state dispute settlement. So option A here is to exclude ISDS, which could be done completely or in relation to certain kinds of measures. And this has been done in relation to the TPP, in relation to tobacco. Option B is controlling ISDS. So for example, states could include requirements that the complaint first be considered by the health authorities of the state's parties. Then the treaty could provide that if the measure satisfied criteria prescribed in the agreement, for example, that it was bona fide, non-discriminatory health measure that was based on evidence, then recourse to ISDS wouldn't be permitted. Option C here is procedural reforms to ISDS, and here really a range of different procedural improvements could be made to reduce the risk of litigation or the threat of litigation that could undermine tobacco control measures. So here it'd be things such as limits on remedies and stringent rules on costs. Now I want to move to consider options that limit the scope or the application of trade or investment obligations. So these options wouldn't absolutely prevent a challenge being brought against a particular tobacco control measure, but they would increase the likelihood of a state being able to successfully defend the claim. So they'd reduce the risk of the state having to pay compensation or to repeal the measure. So here, option D is excluding tobacco control measures from the scope of the agreement. Now, this could potentially increase the risk of other health measures being found inconsistent with trade and investment agreements without careful drafting. Option E here is to limit the scope of substantive obligations. So clarifying the scope of substantive obligations that have proven to be particularly difficult in previous agreements or disputes. So for example, many investment agreements now state that non-discriminatory measures that have been enacted for a public purpose don't constitute compensatable expropriation of an investor's property. Now, option F here is using general exceptions, such as those that are contained in Article 20 of the GATT. And this is sort of one of the most common approaches that are used in international trade agreements to safeguard regulatory autonomy. Now, this slide looks at the relative strengths of these options. And so the strongest option for states to safeguard their ability to implement tobacco control measures is to exclude these measures either from the scope of the relevant preferential trade investment agreement entirely, which is option D, or to exclude them from the scope of ISDS, which is option A. Now, these options would provide the greatest certainty for states in enacting tobacco control measures without the fear of being subject to a legal challenge. But these are also the options that are least likely to be agreed by states where the tobacco industry is quite influential. They can also create the risk of abuse. That is, the exclusion from scrutiny of measures that are designed to protect the tobacco industry, the local tobacco industry, from foreign competitors, for example. And so broader approaches, such as limiting the scope of the substantive obligations, which is option E, or including general exceptions, option F, or reforming dispute settlement procedures, option C, don't provide a high degree of certainty for states, so a state can't be sure whether its tobacco control measures will fall within the scope of the provision. Now, although they don't provide an absolute safeguard, these broader options mitigate some of the risks that preferential trade and investment agreements pose for tobacco control measures and might be more politically feasible. I think states need to consider the utility of these different options on a case-by-case basis and really combine a number of options in a given agreement. Tailoring agreements in this way, responding to the particular textual contexts and interrelationships of each, will provide a more comprehensive approach to safeguarding regulatory autonomy and ensure minimisation both of the potential harms of a dispute arising and the risk of adverse outcome in a dispute. Now, of course, there are also options to improve existing treaties. So it shouldn't just be adopting good practice in relation to treaties going forward, but also looking at existing treaties that are on the books. And here, options include agreed interpretations between the parties, modification or renegotiation of the treaties, or termination of the treaties. The tobacco, alcohol, manufactured food, health insurance, healthcare services, and pharmaceutical industries are well aware of international trade and investment rules and are prepared to use them to prevent or delay health measures that impact on their profitability. But sufficient flexibility does and can exist in international trade and investment law framework, particularly in the WTO, for states to protect their health objectives while remaining compliant with trade and investment law. The law is certainly nuanced with the continued proliferation of preferential trade agreements and bilateral investment treaties increasingly complex. Given the tendency of the industry to capitalise on legal ambiguity by engaging in disruptive and delaying legal tactics, governments must continue to seek greater clarity and security for their national public health interests as they pursue their national trade and investment interests. This enhanced clarity and security can be achieved through action by states' parties in terminating, modifying, clarifying existing future international investment agreements through mechanisms, as I mentioned, of agreed interpretations or textual insertions. States also need to be aware of the risk of regulatory chill and attempt to combat it through robust evidence-based regulation alongside careful treaty drafting and monitoring. And finally, states should adopt a whole-of-government approach, ensuring that there's very close communication between the ministries that are engaged with international health, with public health, as well as the trade, investment, and foreign affairs. Fear, uncertainty, and ignorance of trade and investment agreements need not be accepted as an excuse for not systematically pursuing public health. And the final comment that I want to make is that I'm surprised here that the International Centre for Trade and Sustainable Development is giving a platform to Philip Morris at this conference in the From Drifts to Deals session. The tobacco industry isn't another stakeholder, as has been recognised by the 180 parties of the WHO's Framework Convention of Tobacco Control in Article 5.3 and its guidelines. The new SDGs, Sustainable Development Goals, refer in 3A to the need to strengthen the implementation of the treaties, that treaty in all countries as appropriate, and in 3.4, the need to reduce by one-third by 2030 premature mortality from NCDs. The tobacco industry's only useful contribution to sustainable development would be to close down. Thanks very much.
Thank you very much indeed, Andrew. And then I'll introduce our final speaker, Sanya Reed-Smith, who from the Third World Network, who I know has been following the negotiations already taking place at the WTO here. Sanya.
Thank you very much. So various provisions of trade and investment agreements can have an impact on a wide variety of health policies and laws. These policies and laws can include tobacco control, as we heard, but also alcohol control, whether it's restrictions on advertising or health warning labels, junk food warning labels, regulation of dangerous foods, for example, beef that is contaminated with mad cow disease, bovine spongiform encephalopathy, regulating dangerous chemicals and dangerous industries that can harm health, pollution of the water supply, affordability of medicines, privacy of health data, taxation that's used for health. These are some of the health policies and laws that can be affected by trade and investment rules. So in the WTO, of course, these rules already include on goods, services and intellectual property that can affect health. And as we'll explain later, they are thinking about adding investment to the WTO negotiations with the implications that we've already heard something about. In other trade agreements, such as the recently concluded Trans-Pacific Partnership Agreement, one of these mega-regionals, of the 30 chapters of the text that was released, 13 of these chapters can affect health directly. This is not counting the indirect effects. So 13 chapters can directly undermine your health laws and policies. We don't have time to cover all of them here, but I have more information for those who are interested. And of course, a lot of these rules are subject to a health exception, which we'll discuss the effectiveness of later. So we are here in Nairobi, in the WTO ministerial, or outside the WTO ministerial conference. And one of the issues that the ministers will be deciding here in Nairobi is whether there should be negotiations in the WTO on so-called new issues. And some WTO member countries want to add these new issues to the WTO negotiations. And one of the new issues they want to add is a so-called Singapore issue, which is investment. They did try to add it to the WTO negotiations earlier, but then developing countries said, this is problematic, you cannot negotiate it during the current Doha round. But nevertheless, some countries are still trying to add it here in Nairobi to get investment negotiations back into the WTO. So we've heard from the previous speakers about some of these implications if there are investment rules for some health policies. And I just wanted to add a little bit more. For example, there are some additional cases of this investors suing governments, ISDS, investor to state dispute settlement. For example, when a dangerous chemical was banned because it was harmful to health, the manufacturer of the chemical sued the Canadian government, and the Canadian government settled by reversing the ban. You can still sell the chemical that is dangerous for health. Then they paid $13 million to the manufacturer, and the Canadian government issued a statement for use in advertising saying that current scientific information does not demonstrate the toxicity of this chemical. That's the Canadian government settling. There was another ban by Canada temporarily on a chemical that was dangerous for health. Canada was again sued by the manufacturer. This time Canada defended to the end, they still lost. And they had to pay $5 million to the manufacturer for the lost profits that the company would have made for the 16 months that that chemical was banned. In Mexico, they were worried about a toxic waste dump polluting the water supply, so they did not allow the toxic waste dump. Mexican government was sued, lost, had to pay the foreign investor $15 million. In Peru, there is a smelter that is polluting the environment so badly that 99% of the children have lead poisoning, cadmium at 40 times WHO levels, government had to declare a state of emergency, they ordered the smelter to clean up three times, the smelter did not, so the government shut it down. The smelter is now suing the government for $800 million. In Canada, the government tried to use the flexibilities mentioned by Ted in terms of flexibilities in the WTO rules on patents, to ensure, for example, that patents are not unnecessarily granted for medicines. The Canadian government has been sued by Eli Lilly for $481 million for cancelling patents, and there's a string of cases that are coming if they succeed. So these are some of the cases under these investment rules that ministers are deciding here in Nairobi whether they will add them to the WTO so that all WTO members can face these kinds of cases about these kinds of health issues. This does not count the cases of chilling that were mentioned by Andrew. So, for example, there was a government who did not do their tobacco regulation because they were threatened with being sued under these investment rules. There are others who are waiting to see the outcome of the Philip Morris case against Australia before they also introduce plain packaging. There are also governments who could not afford to defend, for example, Uruguay, until they were bailed out by the former mayor of New York, Bloomberg, to pay the legal fees, because the legal fees can be $58 million in a case, and even when the governments win, 70% of the time they don't even get their lawyers' fees paid by the investors. These investment rules that ministers are deciding here in Nairobi whether they'll add to the WTO include something called fair and equitable treatment of the investor, which sounds fine, but has been interpreted by some tribunals to be a standstill on your laws and regulations. So no new laws, no new regulations, no changing them if this harms the foreign investor. So, for example, we often learn that a chemical is dangerous to health sometime down the track. BPA in baby bottles, we recently banned it. Thalidomide for pregnant women, Vioxx was recalled. We don't always know the health risks immediately. We only found out about BSE beef in I don't know what year. So when you find out about a new health risk, you need to regulate. This could potentially violate this fair and equitable treatment, which is the most common and successful way of suing under these investment treaties. The amount that governments have had to pay in some cases, in this one not involving health, was $50 billion, and the government had 180 days to find the money. In the WTO, if you don't pay it, then there would be tariffs on your exports until you pay. And of course, the US investors are twice as litigious as the next country, and when they sue, they have a broad interpretation of their rights 98% of the time. So it's very difficult for governments to win when they're sued in these cases. What would be the investment rules if the ministers decide here in Nairobi to add them to the WTO negotiations? Well, the US has a strong template of what they require on investment rules. They have a model, and it's very hard to significantly change this. And you can see that in the Trans-Pacific Partnership Agreement, where 11 countries did not succeed in making any significant changes to the provisions I just explained that led to the cases I just explained, except for this exception to ISDS for tobacco control, which tobacco companies are still trying to get removed from the final TPP text. So we're not even sure that that will survive to the end. So if investment is added to the WTO negotiations here in Nairobi, what I expect to be the provisions would be the US model, because that is all they can agree to. It is very hard to get them to make any changes to it. So of course, the Office of the High Commissioner for Human Rights, the UN Special Rapporteur on the Right to Health, have repeatedly expressed concern about these investment provisions. They have called for human rights impact assessments to be done before countries agree to these provisions. So my question to the WTO members here in Nairobi is, have they all done human rights impact assessments and health impact assessments before they agree to new issues here in Nairobi, including investment? Then if we move to other issues such as services, this overlaps with investment in trade rules. And these services rules can come through the World Trade Organization, through free trade agreements such as the Trade and Services Agreement, or TTIP, the Transatlantic Free Trade Agreement, the TPP, EU free trade agreements, including the economic partnership agreements with Africa, including Kenya. So these rules have various aspects. One of them is liberalisation of service sectors. And remember, services is everything you cannot drop on your foot. So obviously health services, but also things like retail, selling tobacco and alcohol, transport, electricity, water, banking, health insurance. So you can see that there are many potential service sectors that can touch on health. So the general services rule is you have to allow foreign investors into the service sector if you liberalise it, if you open it. So for example, if you want to ban tobacco advertising, which I think the FCTC recommends or requires, then you cannot liberalise that sector in these trade rules, because if you open it, you have to allow as much tobacco advertising as the foreigners want to do. So you can't ban tobacco advertising if you've liberalised that sector in a trade agreement, unless we have an exception, which we'll talk about later. So because of this kind of implication of liberalisation, again, the Special Rapporteur on Human Rights have emphasised the importance of WTO members doing human rights health impact assessments before committing to open up health service sectors in trade agreements. So again, I ask the WTO members, have they all done this before they negotiate further liberalisation? Then there are things in the services rules which are commonly called disciplines on domestic regulation. So this is restricting your ability to regulate services. Even regulations that treat foreign companies the same as local companies are restricted by these rules. So for example, it can restrict a government's ability to regulate industries that can be dangerous for health, such as nuclear power stations. If you want to make sure you don't have a repeat of the Fukushima leak and you raise the standards, will that violate these services rules which restrict your ability to regulate? These domestic regulations disciplines can also restrict your ability to use licensing fees as a source of taxation revenue for health, which is done by a number of countries, including at the subnational government level. And of course, governments here may be deciding on the transparency aspect of these disciplines on domestic regulation. But transparency has a particular meaning in trade rules, and it means that you have to allow all companies to comment on your proposed laws. But as we heard from Andrew, under the WHO's Tobacco Control Convention, which 180 countries have joined, which is most WTO members, Article 5.3 says that governments should only interact with the tobacco industry to the extent strictly necessary to enable them to effectively regulate tobacco, because they don't want them influencing the tobacco control laws and policies. So this has been through long, hard-fought experience over decades with the tobacco industry, and they've said, keep them at arm's length. Don't allow them to comment on all your proposed laws as much as they want, because we know, for example, that when the British government was considering plain packaging, Philip Morris was planning to send 18,000 comments to the British government about this. And depending on the transparency rules, sometimes governments have to reply in writing to every comment. Sometimes they have to take those comments into consideration. So what kind of influence does that have on tobacco control rules, but also other health policies, when you have to allow, say, the alcohol industry to comment on your proposed labelling or your proposed advertising of alcohol rules and so on? Then, of course, we come to the goods, the traditional part of trade agreements, reducing the tariffs, the taxes on imported products. So, of course, this can occur through the WTO, and there are two least developed countries joining the WTO here in Nairobi who we expect have to have made significant liberalisation of tariffs, and whether that's on tobacco and alcohol, we have to see. They also probably had to make open many service sectors to get into the WTO. This is also in the goods chapter of free trade agreements, where countries like the US have a general rule that says you must remove all tariffs on all US imports. You might get to keep them on one product. So then you say, well, do I keep them on tobacco or alcohol or rice to protect my rice farmers from the subsidised US rice, which is cheaper than, say, Malaysian rice? So you have to choose who you save. The other aspect of goods which can come up in trade agreements is trade facilitation rules. So here the WTO members are under pressure to ratify the new trade facilitation agreement at the World Trade Organization. And here there's a bit of a clash of spirit and perhaps laws with the World Health Organization's Tobacco Control Convention, because the FCTC has a new protocol to eliminate trade in tobacco, in illicit trade in tobacco products, which is basically to reduce the smuggling of tobacco coming into your country. And a number of WTO members have joined this, others are in the process of joining. But the trade facilitation agreement at the WTO is about making it easier for imports to come in, including tobacco. So the WHO says, make it harder for smuggled tobacco to come in by requiring more documentation and customs checking. The WTO says, make it easier for all imports to come in, including tobacco. Don't require documentation, don't check so much. So you can see that there's a bit of a clash. So have all the countries in the WTO and the ministries of health already checked the compatibility of the trade facilitation agreement at the WTO with the FCTC protocol at the World Health Organization? Free trade agreements also often have these trade facilitation provisions. So again, have they checked the compatibility with the WHO protocol? Is there an exception for tobacco or for health? One of the last few topics to look at is intellectual property, which was mentioned by Ted. These rules, of course, in the WTO say that you have to have patents on everything, including medicines, which is a 20-year monopoly. So 20 years before you can get the generic version that's cheaper, unless you say use compulsory licensing. But least developed countries don't have to do this, as long as they are least developed. What is the implication of patents on medicines? We can see, for example, from medicines for HIV/AIDS, when they were patented, they cost $15,000 per patient per year. When the patent finished and you get generic companies making the same medicine, say in India, and you get competition, the price for that same medicine has fallen to $67 per patient per year, from $15,000 to $67. So you can see the difference that patents and intellectual property makes. So remember, least developed countries don't have to do patents as long as they're least developed. What about the two least developed countries who are joining the WTO here in Nairobi? Did they get this exception, or do they have to give patents on medicines even though they're least developed? Then there are pushes for even stronger intellectual property protection than there is in the WTO. And this comes in free trade agreements with developed countries such as the EU and US, and also in some WTO accession like China's. So this stronger intellectual property protection in various ways, for example, in the Colombia-US free trade agreement, was estimated by a WHO methodology to cost Colombia an extra $1.5 billion per year spending on medicines. If they don't spend that, Colombians will have to cut their medicine consumption by 44%. So even the Australian government was worried about this intellectual property on medicines in the recent Trans-Pacific Partnership Agreement, especially for the new medicines called biologics, which are like vaccines, cancer medicine, insulin for diabetes, because those medicines can be $500,000 per patient per year when they're protected by intellectual property, and even for governments as rich as Australia's, that becomes unaffordable. So, of course, the UN Special Rapporteur on the Right to Health has said that developing countries should not agree to this stronger intellectual property protection, and developed countries should not ask for it because it is incompatible with the right to health. And yet we see the US and the European Union and Switzerland and so on insisting on stronger intellectual property in their trade agreements and developing countries agreeing to it. So the last couple of areas to touch on is, of course, that the medicine reimbursement systems, such as the pharmaceutical benefit scheme in Australia, can be undermined by the so-called transparency provisions in the TPP, which give the pharmaceutical companies more influence on how much they are paid by the government when the government subsidises them. So again, it goes to the affordability of subsidising medicines in various countries like Australia and New Zealand. The e-commerce issue comes up in a variety of places. It may be added here in Nairobi as a new issue in the WTO or an expansion of the existing e-commerce rules, because the US has made a proposal here in the WTO, which they got into the Trans-Pacific Partnership Agreement and they have proposed in the Trade and Services Agreement, which can undermine the privacy of health data. It can mean that patients' health records can be sent to another country where there are no privacy laws and the data can be sold to advertisers and health insurers and other foreign governments can read it and so on. So, are there any health exceptions for all of these rules? In the WTO, there is a health exception that applies to some of the WTO rules, and that health exception is often copied into free trade agreements. It's not always in investment treaties, for example. But this health exception is difficult to use. You have to pass five different tests, and these exceptions generally in the WTO, countries have tried to use them 44 times in the history of the WTO. They've succeeded once, asbestos. 43 out of 44 times has failed. So there's a question about how effective that health exception is, and of course in US free trade agreements such as the Trans-Pacific Partnership Agreement, the US never allows the health exception to apply to the investment chapter, which has implications for health, as you heard in the cases. They don't allow it to apply to the intellectual property chapter, which obviously has implications for medicine prices. So it's only partial and it only applies to some sections and it's difficult to use. What about tax? Because tobacco tax, alcohol tax, these issues can be something called expropriation of the investors' profits. So even the US recognises this and has a tax exception. But it's only partial. It only saves your lowest common denominator taxes that all the governments agree are okay. So if you have, say, a high alcohol tax or a high tobacco tax or a soft drink tax that other governments do not agree with, then they might say that's not a tax that's allowed, and you can still be sued and lose under these agreements. So because of these problems for health, the UN Special Rapporteurs, including for health, have repeatedly expressed concern, recommended countries do human rights impact assessments before agreeing to these measures, including those that are being decided on here in Nairobi. But the trade ministries seem to keep continuing to negotiate these provisions, both here in Nairobi and in free trade agreements and in the WTO in Geneva. So it's not clear that there's coherence in the governments between what the health ministries are trying to do, say on tobacco control under the World Health Organization's convention, and what their own trade ministry is negotiating. And this is often because the trade ministry may not know the WHO tobacco control rules, and the health ministry doesn't know what's being negotiated in trade. So everything just sort of falls between the gaps and health suffers. Thank you.
Thank you very much indeed. Three very comprehensive, interesting presentations. I'll now invite questions or comments from the floor, and I'd ask you to first introduce yourself and then make your question and comment. Somebody there has a microphone. So who would like to begin? I see silence. Yes, please, in the front here.
Thank you for interesting presentations. My name is Lauren Johnston. I'm also at Melbourne University, but in the School of Economics. I have only one observation. I'm not a health person at all. But from my time in Sierra Leone, I remember I worked for the Ministry of Finance of Sierra Leone for a while, and I remember there was some debate on whether development leads to security or whether security leads to development. And at that time, I wondered if in the short term security led to development, but in the long term development led to security. And I wonder if there's a parallel there for health, which is maybe this trade and investment in the short term possibly increases the risks for health in terms of the spread. And I also lived in China for several years, and I was told explicitly by a GP that I saw that certain antibiotics would no longer work on me just for having, literally just for having drunk water in China for and eaten the food. They said, oh, well, how long have you been here? And I said, several years. And they said, well, forget all these drugs. They'll no longer work on you. So I just went, in the short term, if it makes it much, if it makes it worse, but maybe in the long run, if all those effects come into play in terms of growth and so on, if it improves the health environment. I guess that's directed at Ted. I don't know if there's been a lot of analysis on that.
Yeah, well, that, I mean, there are a couple of different threads of argument there. The example of antimicrobial resistance, and by the by, regulations on the use of veterinary antibiotics are, I suspect, one of the health measures that will be impugned under trade and investment agreements in the future, if that hasn't already happened, really undermines your case in that antimicrobial resistance is, for all practical purposes, forever. There is no way growth will enable you to compensate for antimicrobial resistance. That's the first point. The second point is that under some circumstances, growth leads to wealth, leads to health argument is valid. I mean, we know that over the long haul and with a lot of outliers around the Preston curve, richer is healthier, that's partly an effect of the diffusion of medical advances. And one of the unanswered questions about the new generation of trade and investment disciplines is whether they will facilitate or hinder that diffusion, and much depends on how the intellectual property regime plays out in individual TRIPS plus agreements. But, and here I'm not speaking for the panel, but I'm speaking based on a lot of the political science of globalization, we know that globalization is disequalizing. We know the tendency is to create new cartographies of wealth and health within national borders, in which inequalities tend to become magnified, so that what was true of growth in the past may or may not be true of growth in the future, because the dynamics within nations are quite different. Just to give you an illustration of what I mean by that, a week or so after he won the Nobel Prize in Economics this year, Angus Deaton and his wife, it was really his really her study, published an interesting analysis of the rapid increase in mortality in midlife among non-Hispanic white men in the United States under conditions of rapidly rising inequality. And the increase in mortality, which is quite substantial, is basically from the diseases of desperation, chronic liver diseases, drugs and alcohol poisoning, and suicide. This looks a lot like the early stages of the life expectancy decline that followed the implosion of the Russian economy after the collapse of the former Soviet Union. So I think there's really a case to be made that growth may, depending on its conditions, in fact lead to increasing health inequalities within national borders. That's not to say there isn't something to your argument, but I think under the conditions of contemporary globalization, it's probably increasingly tenuous.
Just to add to this, on the economics side, do trade agreements lead to growth in the first place? So one example that I've been looking at recently is the Trans-Pacific Partnership Agreement. And the US government did a study which assumed that all the tariffs are removed between TPP countries, which did not actually happen in the final text. And they found that for most TPP countries, the increase in growth would be 0%. The best was Vietnam, and they got a 0.1% increase in growth by 2025. That's the US government's projection, and that was overly optimistic because, in fact, all the tariffs were not removed in the TPP, and it does not take account of things like the yarn forward rule that restricts Vietnam's ability to export textiles and clothing at 0% tariffs into the US. When we look at, say, the goods trade balance, studies have shown that Malaysia in the TPP will see its goods trade balance worsen when the TPP comes into a force, because its imports will increase by more than its exports, because its current tariffs are higher than the tariffs, say, of the US. So if the benefits of trade agreements like the TPP are so little or negative, where are the benefits that outweigh the costs? For example, in health. We've only looked at health here. We haven't yet looked at the environment, at affirmative action policies, at the right to education, at industrialization, at supporting local farmers and food security. So just on the health side, there are clear costs, and yet the benefits are not clear from some trade agreements like the TPP. Of course, for the WTO, it's a different story, because if you're not in it, then the 162 WTO countries can have high tariffs on your exports to them. So for countries that are export dependent, they need to join the WTO. But there are some countries that have not joined the WTO, like small Pacific Island countries who rely on fishing and don't really export very much. Do they need to join the WTO? Many of them are not WTO members. So it's not always clear that even the trade leads to growth part leads to health. If part of the equation is there, before you even get to the issues that Ted raised about inequalities and other aspects.
Thank you. Do I have another question or comment from the audience? Please, in the front here.
Thank you. My name is Pauline Vachbinger. I'm a primary care physician and researcher with the African Population and Health Research Center here in Nairobi, and an alumnus of University of Oslo. Happy to be here, an interesting presentation. Coming from a heavily health background, my comments and questions might be kind of skewed that way. From the presentation, it comes out that surely and clearly there's a lot of negativity coming out of TIAs in a way that they, for instance, multinational corporations taking advantage of low middle income countries, amongst others. And of course, for me, coming from an assets-based approach to health, I'm concerned. And in my way of trying to promote this, speaking as a health researcher, I would want to look at what works. Do we have examples of TIAs that have promoted health? So as I am engaging with policymakers, with other researchers, and trying to, you know, to see how we can make TIAs work, do we have case studies across the world that we know we can draw upon? And I say this obviously because I've not read the report that the panel puts together. And yes, so that's largely what I want to hear about. It's, in a way, it's just giving the presentation life. I like the recommendations, the summary of the recommendations by Ted. And so for me, when I'm pushing it ahead, I mean, I'd say, so for instance, can we draw from this example? How do we promote this? Thank you.
Thank you. Perhaps, Andrew, could you, or yeah,
Andrew.
I'm not sure that we have. I think we could certainly do a lot better. And so most of the engagement that I've seen with these trade investment agreements by the health departments has been more of a sort of defensive approach in relation to these agreements, perhaps rather than seeing, look, can we be more creative and imaginative when, creating these agreements so that they better serve health. But I don't have sort of too much more to say about it.
Yeah, I would agree that, I mean, probably the best examples we have are the health attempted health exceptions. And so in the TPP, the exception to investor to state dispute settlement for tobacco control, that's a first. And of course, Malaysia was trying to get it to be an exception to the whole 30 chapters of the TPP for tobacco control. But in the course of negotiations, all they could get was an exception to the investor to state dispute settlement. So that means that governments can still sue each other under the investment rules for tobacco control. It just stops the investors from suing. The investors being tobacco companies like Philip Morris. And we know that governments do sue about tobacco control because Andrew went through the WTO cases where they're suing Australia. And what we see is that it was admitted publicly that the tobacco industry is paying governments to sue Australia at the WTO. So just because it's state to state, governments suing each other, doesn't mean that the tobacco companies are not paying governments to sue, because some of the governments who are suing Australia actually export no tobacco to Australia. They have no market interest in suing Australia, but they're doing so because they were paid by the tobacco companies. So just because you get rid of investor-to-state dispute settlement for tobacco control doesn't entirely save you, because governments still can and do sue over things like tobacco control. And some of the TPP countries, for example, the governments still own tobacco companies. They are state-owned tobacco companies like Japan Tobacco and I think Vietnam's Vinataba. So they may have more of an interest in suing to protect their interests of their government-owned tobacco companies. So, yes, we have some examples of health exceptions, but we're still not quite there because, for example, even tobacco control in the Trans-Pacific Partnership Agreement can be undermined by, say, 11 TPP chapters, and we only got an exception to half of one TPP chapter. So probably the most risky in the sense that that's the one that tobacco companies can sue under, but still governments can sue to enforce the other 10 chapters plus the investment chapter that can restrict tobacco control measures. And then some of those chapters have the health exception, but that's the health exception that generally works one out of 44 times, so may not be able to be relied on. So we've been talking here about investment mostly because, number one, that's the issue they're deciding here in Nairobi, whether they'll add it to the WTO negotiations. And that would mean, for example, if they add investor to state dispute settlement, that the US companies who are the most litigious and get interpretations, broad interpretations of their rights 98% of the time, can sue governments for their health measures, including tobacco control, alcohol control, regulation of dangerous chemicals and mining and so on. And the question then is whether the WTO would keep its existing health exception if and apply that to the investment rules. It's not a foregone conclusion that it would apply to the investment rules. And then it's still the old exception from 1945 that, you know, hasn't been updated and has only worked one out of 44 times in the history of the WTO. So it may need to be revamped for new times. And then the question is, you know, what is the effective wording? Because trade ministries negotiate trade agreements and their general purpose is to open things for trade and investment. So they don't want to allow countries to be protectionist, governments to be protectionist. So, for example, the health ministry might say, we want a very effective exception that says nothing in this agreement restricts governments from taking any measure that they deem appropriate for health. That would be subjective, strong health exception. The government, the health ministry decides what they need to do and nobody can sue them for it. That's based on the security exception that is in trade agreements, including the WTO. So governments decide for themselves what they need to do and nobody can challenge that. But trade ministries tend to say, well, that's too broad. It can be interpreted in a protectionist way. You could drive a truck through it and say, this is for health reasons, and instead do something protectionist that blocks the exports of another country. So trade ministries are worried about protectionism usually, so they may not like to have an exception as broad and easy to use and effective as a health ministry might want. And then it becomes a debate inside the government within, say, the cabinet about what is the final position of the government. Do they agree to investment being added to the WTO, even though there have been all of these cases where, under these investment rules, health measures have successfully been challenged, including regulations of dangerous chemical and mining, and now tobacco is being challenged? And if they do they get an exception? Because so far, the history has not been great in getting effective exceptions. So it's, sorry, the short answer to your question is we should do better. It's hard to, and I think maybe one of the only ways is through exceptions and carve-outs, because it's hard to imagine realistically that there will not be trade agreements. And the kind of basic trade agreement is tariffs, trading goods. But as you get into other areas, then the health implications can become even more when you have investment, intellectual property, and so on.
Ted, did you want to
go? Okay. Any more questions or comments on this one? In the third row.
Okay, my name is Jennifer Mwindi, and I'm from I'm a corporate relationship manager from Kenya Commercial Bank, KCB. From the presentation, I've gathered that there are so many established regulations and rules, especially pertaining to cigarettes, to tobacco, and alcohol. Yet, from the presentation, we have seen there's a rise of the risk, especially on attributed to unhealthy foods, causing overweight and obesity. I don't know whether there is any work going on in terms of also regulating the unhealthy foods sector, to curb some of these risks that are arising from that. That's my question.
Well, sorry, to clarify, whether there is any work going on
on regulations, to come up with regulations, laws, to try and curb.
To curb these.
That are coming up.
Yes, indeed there is. Andrew, would you like to?
So there's a range of work being done. So there are, some countries have experimented with things such as sugar taxes. Others have adopted traffic light systems to make it very clear to consumers that a particular product, label it red, orange or green, say, for how much sugar it's got or how much fat or salt it has, and to, recognising that consumers find it very hard to understand the current nutritional information on the back of packets and provide information that's much clearer. And then there's also been soft drink taxes that have been introduced in some countries, recognising that this is a nutrition's very complex, but sugary soft drinks have no nutritional value whatsoever.
Just to add, and then so in addition, and so the taxes that were mentioned by Andrew could also be challenged under the trade and investment agreements if there's not a sufficient tax exception, because it could be expropriation of the profits that the company expected to make because you've reduced the profits. So then you would need to have a tax exception. But so far the tax exceptions, if they apply to investment, which they don't always, are only partial. So the ones that I've seen only save taxes that all governments agree on. So if some countries don't think you should have a soft drink tax or a sugar tax, then they would not agree and you can still be sued successfully. The other one that I know of is junk food warning labels that Andrew mentioned. So for example, Chile was going to have a warning label on junk food that took 20% of the package and was red, stop sign. Then in the Trans-Pacific Partnership Agreement negotiations, this was discussed, and so the warning label was reduced to 7.5% and the colour was changed to green. Green is good. Junk food is good. So this can also be, these kinds of warning labels can also be restricted in trade agreement negotiations.
Yeah. Yeah, I also wanted to mention that WTO has something called a Technical Barriers to Trade Committee. One of the major categories of what are called specific trade concerns that are brought to that committee involves traffic light labeling of nutritional content. That's just WTO. That's not the investor state dispute provisions in various bilateral investment treaties. So there's a whole structure of impediments to dealing with the nutrition transitions and the increases in overweight and obesity that, as David Stuckler and others have shown, are quite directly correlated with liberalization of trade and investment. No, correlation doesn't imply causation, as we know in public health, but the weight of evidence is pretty substantial there.
Right, thank you very much. We are running over time, and I've had the sign from the organizers that we should now begin to wrap up. So I would just like to thank very much my co-panelists and the audience for a very lively session. I would invite you to follow our work. I've given the references here to the independent panel on global governance for health, which will be publishing our report in the Lancet within the next few months and being formally presented in Oslo in February. And I understand also that this session has been taped and recorded, so that if you've missed something or you arrived late, then I would invite you to have a look at that on the internet. So again, many thanks to all of you, and I hope you enjoy the rest of the day.